Father, I just thank you, first of all, for being able to have the privilege to stand here and deliver your word. Father, I just ask that you would, like Pastor said, just overwhelm these words with your anointing, that it would be your words that are being spoken and not mine. Father, I know you have had me prepare these, and I have prepared, but Father, if you want to say something, Lord, you have free will to say whatever you need to say. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yes.
It seems like there's a little bit more ring in there, but
he'll talk and he'll get it.
Okay, go ahead. Well, God's been laying on my heart about. I've been asking him a question. Why is it that it seems like the Christians, a lot of us, are struggling? You know, and we're always taught that God wants us to walk in blessings. God wants us to walk in provision. And yet, I look around, people around me, and it seems like they're not there. So I'm asking the question, and this applies to me. This hit me right between the eyes. A lot of this did, you know. So I'm asking the question, why aren't we seeing the miracles? Why aren't we seeing the things that you want us to walk in our lives? And so I got to thinking about it, and God wants us to walk in plenty. He wants us to walk in plenty. He doesn't want us to be out on the streets begging for something to eat. You know, the Bible says, I don't want my children begging for bread. So he doesn't want us out. And if you're in that, and I've been homeless, I've been in that situation. But don't stay there. And God doesn't want us to stay there. And the thing is, that was just for a season, and I'm not condemning anybody that's there. I'm just saying that's not where God wants us to be.
That's right.
It's not where he wants us to stay.
Right.
And so there's some principles that I would like to bring out today. And I would like to start with one of the most familiar scriptures when we're in Sunday school that we've had, and that's Jesus feeding the 5,000.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Very familiar scripture. But if you want to go ahead and take that away, that's great.
All right, so Mark 6, 30 through 44, and I'm reading out of the NIV. The apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all they had done and taught. Then because so many people were coming and going, and they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, Come with me by yourself to a quiet place and get some rest. So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. By this time, it was late in the day, so his disciples came to him. This is a remote place, they said, and it's already very late. Send the people away so that they can go to their surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat. But he answered, you give them something to eat. They said to him, that would take more than half a year's wages. Are we to go spend that much on bread and give it to them to eat? How many loaves do you have? He asked. Go and see. When they found out, they said, five and two fish. Then Jesus directed them to have all the people sit down in groups on the green grass. So they sat down in groups of hundreds and fifties. Taking the five loaves and the two fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to his disciples and distributed it to the people. He also divided the fish among them. They all ate and were satisfied. And the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces of bread and fish. The number of men who would have eaten was 5,000.
Good, thanks. If you have a paper scripture, when that scripture pops up on the screen, just come up here and Gene will hand you the microphone. So do you notice what Jesus said first? He said, how much do you have? He already knew there was something. It was something available. And I think that's a lesson that even before I get into that we need to consider. What do you have? What do you have? You know, what does Gene have? What does Carolyn have? What does Stephanie have? What does anybody else have? Name Drew Blank for a second, sorry. But what do we have? Because every one of us has something different. You know, some people could give $1,000 and not miss it. Some people, you know, have time and they can give that time. So whatever you have, God wants us to give. I also think of that, the widow, and she gave her 2 mites. And Jesus said that was more than the people that were given large sums of money. Why? Because that's all she had. And she gave all she had. So what do you have? That's the first, before I start any of this, I want you to think, while I'm speaking, I want you to think about, what do I have? What is available for me to use? Okay? But the first thing Jesus did was he made an appeal. He asked, what is there? What's available? Isn't that right? Mm-hmm. He asked. Matthew 7, who's got that one? Matthew 7, 7 through 8. And who's got Matthew 20, 21, 22? Who's got that one? Okay.
It says, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. And he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, it will be opened.
Yeah. Hang on just a minute. No, you can go. Go ahead. Matthew 21, 22. Go ahead and read that one.
And whatsoever things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive.
And Luke, you got Luke 18, 1 through 8? Okay.
Mm-hmm. Then he spoke a parable to them that men should always pray and not faint. I got to see this thing. Saying, there was a certain city judge who did not fear God nor regard man. Now there was a widow in that city, and she came to him saying, get justice for me from my adversary. And he would not for a while, but afterward he said within himself, though I do not fear God nor regard man, yet because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. Then the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge said, and shall God not avenge his own elect who cried out day and night to him, though he bears long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth?
Okay. So, again, mean to ask, but how do we ask? We ask specifically. If we have a specific need, God wants us to ask specific. You know, it's like I've always heard, well, if it's your will, God, I need, you know, and then people don't ask specifically. When we were taught to pray, now we're taught to pray. If there's a knee that's need to heal, we get down and specifically pray for that knee. And if we know what particular part of the body functions aren't working like it should, then we pray specifically. The reason why that is because it our words have power, and we'll get into that in a minute. But our words have power, and if the more specific you are, the more you can concentrate that power into that area. So Jesus said, what do we have? What's there? He asked. You know, he put this principle in action. He said, but where is it? Because he knew there was something there. Because we carry everything with us that we need. And then ask in faith. You know, a lot of times we'll ask God, but then we'll turn around and say, well, I don't think it's going to happen. What have we done? What have we done? You know, well, that can't, you know, I've dealt with this. I've dealt with diabetes for so long. God just can't heal it. Or God doesn't want to heal it. You know, that's our mindset. Even though we may not vocalize that, we've already defeated ourselves because we don't have the faith to believe that God's going to overcome it. Now, I'm not talking about just finances here. I'm talking about plenty. You know, what is plenty? And I'll get into that in a little bit, but apply this to every part of our lives. It's not just our finances. You know, that's a big one. That's an obvious one, but it applies to every part of our life. But be relentless. You know, a lot of times when we pray, we pray, well, I prayed for that once. Well, maybe you did, but maybe God wants to see how serious you are about the provision that you ask him for. Just like that widow woman, man, she just said, I'm not going to give up. You know, I'm not going to give up. Or I've been praying for my knee to be healed. Well, it happened gradually. Yeah. People begin to pray for it, and I feel a little bit better, and feel a little bit better, and feel a bit better. And as I continue to be relentless, guess what happened? It got healed. Amen. Now, do I still feel a little tense? Yeah, every once in a while, but that doesn't mean it's not being healed. See what I'm saying? Yes. We just keep going back to God saying, yeah, it's being healed, and I know it's being touched. Amen. And so, if we just keep bombarding heaven, when we don't see the results that we want to see, then we just keep going. Hey, God, you know, hey, Father, let's keep going asking Father. But here's another one, too, expecting. A lot of times we say that, you know, we know God can do it, but we don't walk in that door, or we don't ask for prayer and then expect something to happen. And if we're not expecting it to happen, it's not going to happen. Sorry, but it's just not. I mean, it may happen because somebody else is expecting it. But if there's no expectation that something's going to happen, it's not going to happen. You know, if the disciples didn't listen to Jesus and expect something to happen, it was not going to happen in this case. And if they weren't being obedient and following out everything that Jesus had said, guess what? It wasn't going to happen. And when we ask, we need to ask in the will of God. Now, I honestly think that God wants us to be, I mean, his will is for us to be whole. His will is for us to walk in plenty. So when we're asking for things, it's not to ask for our own selves as much as it is for his kingdom. But I can't give what I don't have. Right? Yeah. At least that's what we think. But we can. Look what the disciples did with the loaves and the fishes. When they began to break it up and begin to share it, guess what happened? It multiplied. If they would have never shared it, if they would have never gave what they had, it would have never been multiplied. That, you know, seriously, that's the principle. So we always have something with us that we can give. And it may not be what we think is a lot, but we'll never get more if we don't share what we have. You know, God has been challenging me because, there's giftings and callings on all of us. And he's saying, if you don't share what you have, I'm not going to give you more. And as I've been sharing what God has been given to me, and I have fun with it, but I'll touch or I'll point at somebody or whatever, and that comes and goes to them. Right? Or they feel it. Yes, yeah. Well, if I just keep it to myself, if I just hold that fire to myself, guess what? That fire is going to go out. Mm-hmm. But as I spread it to each person, then when I come back together and meet with you guys again, guess what? That fire that I gave to you now comes back to me. Yes. in a stronger way. You see what I'm saying? And so it's just the same thing. It's the same thing with anything. If we are wanting to walk in plenty, then we have to give what we have. And in order for me to increase, in order for me to have plenty, I need to be sharing what I have. So apprehend, or to catch. You go looking. Go looking for it. You know, we're not going to find what we're not looking for. You know, and here's another thing. If I'm out there and I'm looking for... If I'm all the time saying, well, it's not going to happen, or, man, this is a bad day. I woke up on the wrong side of the bed. Guess what? You're going to have a bad day. You've just said. I mean, I've gone to work, and I work around people now, a lot of them, people, different people coming in and out, and with different, oh, believe me, they're, some of the things they say is like, and I'll say, how you doing? You know, and I honestly care. And they say, well, I'm having a bad day. I said, well, you know what? I started out with not feeling very good this morning, but I made my mind up that I was going to have a good day. And some people look at me like, how can you make your mind up to have a good day? Then I tell them, you know, hey, look, you can have a good day or you can have a bad day. It's up to you. And so I'm actually preaching to them. They don't know it, but I'm actually preaching to them because it's God's principle. And if we're going to walk in plenty, we have to have that. We have to have that mindset because you're going to find what you're looking for. If I'm looking for gold, I'm going to find gold. If I'm looking for good in somebody, guess what I'm going to find? I'm going to find the good in them. And if I'm looking for bad in somebody, guess what I'm going to find? The bad. I'm going to see what I'm looking for. So my attitude has been challenged to look for the good. Because if I'm looking for the good, if I'm looking for the gold, everybody has gold in them. Everybody has something that God has placed in them to as a value, or we wouldn't be here. God values all of us. And so what we need to do, if we're going to walk in plenty, we need to look for those in other people, not ourselves. Because as we begin to look for the gold in other people, guess what happens? We begin to see our value in His kingdom. And we begin to walk in the value. And then God, we see the plenty that's already in our life. Find ways to make it happen. And this is one that challenges me the most. Because I'll sit back and I have these wonderful ideas. I have a wonderful idea about an invention on a car that's revolutionary. Nobody's ever done it before. Ford hasn't done it. Chevy hasn't done it. But I don't know how to make that happen. So now I have to research and try to figure out a way to make that happen. He's challenging me. There has to be a way to make it happen. But figure out how to make it happen. Move towards that. Move towards that goal. Because I say this a lot, but God cannot steer. You cannot steer a car, parked car. You can't. The only way you can make a car move is if it's moving. And the only way you can make it turn is if it's moving. You can sit there and play in that car all day long with the steering wheel and it's not doing a thing. And it's the same way with us walking in plenty. If I'm going to walk in plenty, I need to get moving. I need to, you know, I need to get my rear in gear. So I need to move. See, the disciples, they moved. When Jesus said, what do we have? Well, they went and did research. They found the boy with the lunch. And then they did what God told them to do. They began to divide it up. And if they wouldn't have moved, they would have never saw that miracle. They would have never saw the things being multiplied. Okay, so who has Psalms 1 or 9, 1 through 2? Okay.
I will give thanks to the Lord with all my heart. I will tell of all your wonders. I will be glad and exult in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High.
And you got Philippians 4:8?
I do.
Well, go ahead and read it.
Yeah, let me read that. Philippians 4:8, that's right. Finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there is any excellence and anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things.
If I were to give my kids something when they were younger and they looked at me and didn't appreciate it, do I really want to give them anything else? No. Well, it's the same way I'm thinking of the children of Israel. How many times did they whine and complain when they were going in the wilderness? And, you know, God would finally, you know, say, well, okay, well, I'll give you manna. All right, you're complaining. And then they got tired of the manna, just the manna. So God, okay. I mean, he finally gave in, but were they grateful for what they had? Not really. And so it took 40 years for them to realize, hey, wait a minute, a two-year trip took 40 years for them. Why? Because they kept complaining. They weren't happy with what God had given them. And when they did finally get to the place where they were ready to go into they still thought it was impossible. After God had sustained them for 40 years, same clothes, same shoes, everything, Everything they needed for that 40 years was supplied to them. And they still thought it was impossible when they got ready to go in. Because they couldn't find, they couldn't quit complaining. They couldn't quit complaining. So complaining puts us in a negative mindset. And what mindset we have is what we attract. So if we are a negative mindset, we're going to attract negative things.
True.
And if we're in a positive mindset, we're going to attract positive things and positive people. I watched my wife go through a transformation. You know what the biggest transformation was? I can. That was before it was I can't. I can't do that. I can't do that. But when she made up her mind and had a positive mindset that I can, guess what happened? She began to do. And so it's just a matter of I can and I will. Even if it looks impossible to us. Even if it looks impossible. Why? Because the strength, it's not our own strength that's going to do it anyway. It's God's strength.
That's right.
Yeah.
Amen.
Because when we complain, it stops the flow. It stops the flow of His blessings. It's like putting a lid over the cauldron. Mm-hmm. And nothing can go in it. Complaints stop everything. And it increases the negative. Complaining does. And one of the things that the children of Israel did was, when they started complaining, they started looking back. They said, oh, it was better when we had in Egypt, when we had the leeks and the garlic and all this other stuff. Was it better? They were enslaved there. Because they're complaining. Their complaining got them to the place where they looked back instead of forward. And when you look back, you'll never gain. You always lose. They got to the place where they thought being in slavery was better than being free, because they kept complaining and they couldn't see the good. They had a negative mindset, and so I think a lot of the problem is our mindset. I really do, and I'm speaking to myself because you know this applies to me too. But I think if we can get over that negative mindset and think, well, I can't do this, there'd be a lot more, we would see a lot more things happen in our lives. Yeah. Who has Proverbs 18:21? Okay.
The tongue has the power of life and death. Those who love it will eat its fruit.
Power of life and death is in the tongue. You're going to get what you speak out. Dan Pallone at men's meeting one time challenged me. He's been challenging me. He challenged all of us, but he challenged me specifically. He said, speak out what you want. So I said, I'm a millionaire. So I began to speak out, I'm a millionaire. Do I see it yet? No. Does my bank account say that? No. But I'm a millionaire. And if I keep speaking that out, guess what's going to happen? Power of life and death is in our tongue. Where's that going to happen? Where's that going to happen? It's going to happen here first. It's going to happen here first. It happens in our heart first. Because out of the abundance of the heart, the man speaketh. And whatever he speaks, he acts upon. So if we're going to walk in plenty, then we need to act on that. But we also need to speak on it. And we'll never get to the place where we're acting on it if we can't speak it out first. And we'll never get to the place where we speak it out first if it's not in our heart first. So in order to get it ingrained in our heart is to keep telling you over and over again. That's why I keep telling myself, I'm a millionaire. I'm a millionaire. Why? Because it's going to be ingrained in my heart. The more I say it, the more it gets ingrained in my heart, the more I can believe it. And the more I believe it, the more I speak it, and the more I walk it out. It's just it's a simple principle, but it works. And, you know, and I'm guilty of this as myself, not walking out this, walking in plenty like I should, like God wants me to. Now, walking in plenty, does that mean that everyone that calls themselves a Christian or walks out, follows after Christ is going to be a millionaire? No. No, it doesn't. And I'll get into that in a minute. But if we use what we have, just like the disciples did, it'll grow. It will grow. And God will increase it. God will increase it. As we speak it out, as we speak out, I'm a millionaire. Guess what's going to happen? My mindset begins to change. When Stephanie says, I can do this, or what if? What if? What if I do this? What will happen if I do this? As she began to do that, her mindset changed from I can't to I can. And then as her mindset began to say, as she began to say to herself, I can, I can, I can, guess what happened? She did. And she's doing. She would have never got to that place if her mindset was where it was. And she changed that mindset by speaking it out. I'm going to do this. She said, I'm determined I'm going to do this. I'm going to lose this weight. And I'm going to get healthy. And I'm going to be able to walk in a marathon. I'm going to be able to run. This is from someone who couldn't walk, could barely walk. It hurt every step. But if she would have stayed there, that's where, if her mindset wouldn't have changed, that's where she would have stayed. Yeah. I can't. Honey, can you go get a cart for me so I can go shopping? Honey, can you take me to the front door? Now, she don't care if I park, all the 20, 40 spaces away. She don't care now. We walk.
That's good.
Because her mindset has changed. But, that's how you walk in plenty. And continue in that. You know, it's not something that you do like, well, you get to a point where you get to a certain point and then you stop. You have to continue.
Yes.
In order for this to happen, in order for this to really take root, it has to be a continual thing.
Right. Good.
But really, when it boils down to, We've talked about making an appeal. We've talked about apprehending. We've talked about an appreciation, and we talked about applying. Mm-hmm. But what it really boils down to, all inclusive, is spiritual first. Yes. If we're not walking in plenty spiritually, if we're not able to feed ourselves and to walk in His anointing and to do the things spiritually first, guess what? None of because we're spirit first.
Yeah.
Whether man wants to admit it or not, whether this flesh wants to admit it or not, whether our soul wants to admit it or not, we're spirit first. Because we were a lump of clay, worthless piece of clay, until God breathed His Holy Spirit in us. Yes. That's when we became who we are today, in the image of God. Until then, we were just nothing else but just a lump of dirt. You know, it may have looked beautiful. God may have molded it and shaped it just beautiful and beautiful statue. But guess what? It was still a lump of clay. Until He breathed into Adam, then we became who we are.
Yes.
And He breathed His Spirit into us. He breathed His very Holy Spirit into us. And that's when we became who we are. We're spirit first. So let's get healthy spiritually. God wants us to also walk in. I'm trying to wrap this up. God also wants us to walk in health.
Amen.
He wants us to walk in plenty of finances, and He wants us to have to be able to flow in our giftings and our anointings. He wants us to be able to give to other people the things that He's given in us. We can't give. We can't give if we're all going to hang on. See, God's kingdom's not like man's kingdom. The more you give it away, the more you get. You know, in man's kingdom, it's like, well, if you want more, you gotta save, you gotta hang on to it, you gotta invest it, you gotta do this and that. Yeah, and that's true. But you invest differently in the kingdom of God because you give it away. You empty yourself into other people, and guess what? God fills that up again with His Holy Spirit. Why? Because we're spirit first. He breathed in us. So that voice, if we're given the Spirit of God that He breathed in us to somebody else, guess what happens? He breathes into us again. Why? Because we're spirit first. And if we're following after Him, our spirit's going to be healthy and we're going to walk in plenty. So my challenge is for to to walk in the in spiritual plenty. Because when we walk in spiritual plenty, all these other things have to follow. If our spirit's first, guess what? Our soul has to follow. Our body has to follow. Yes. Everything physical has to follow. Amen. So our health has to follow. Yes. Now, does that mean that we're all going to be healthy and no sickness and no illness? No, I'm not saying that. What I am saying is this. The potential for us to change that is better if we learn how to walk in plenty.
Sure.
Yes. But it will never... I've prayed for people, and it irritates me. Because I'll pray for them, and they'll say, well, right after I get done praying for them, well, you know, I've been struggling with this for years, you know, and I'm like, you just talked yourself out of it. Just talked yourself out of it. And it's the same thing with anything. I don't want to be poor. I don't. And then I got to thinking, too, I don't have to be poor. I may not get finances, you know, I may not get money, physical money. But really, what do I have these hands, and I can do a lot of things with these hands. I can cook. I can build a house. I wire a house. I can plumb a house. I can work on my car. Those are things that some people have to pay for. I don't have to. Why? Because I have the knowledge and the ability to do them. That's money I don't have to spend. See? So do I have plenty in that? Right? Yeah. So we have, it's our mindset. Again, it's changing our mindset to walk in and prepare ourselves to be walking in plenty. Because God wants us all to walk in plenty. All of us. And so I want to wrap this up with a prayer. Father, I just ask right now, you help us to walk in plenty. But you desire for us to walk in plenty. And you give us all the tools to walk in plenty. So, Father, I just ask that you would take these simple words that you spoke tonight. Help us to apply them to our lives.
Yes, Jesus.
That we would walk in plenty, not just learn how to walk in plenty, but actually do that.
Yeah, God.
And then we would see, Lord, it may not be financial. It may not be certain areas of our life, but there's always plenty if we just walk in it. So, Father, I just give you praise and glory, and I thank you so much. For teaching me and challenging me to walk in plenty as well. In Jesus' name.